Quick Talk with Vijay Narayan, brought to you by Bonwell.
Good evening, Bula Vinaka and Namaste. You are on Straight Talk, and what a journey we have been having with all the political parties coming in and telling you what their policies are, what they will be doing over the next few days as we approach September 17th, the day of the general elections, and how things will play out. We have one political party yet to appear on Straight Talk, and that's Fiji First. And we have continued to ask for the availability of Fiji First representatives. We have been assured that that will be confirmed in the next few days, and they will be appearing in the talkbacks on our elections, Straight Talk talkbacks, starting, of course, in the next few days with double up political party representatives. And tomorrow we expected to have the first one of that sort, where we have two parties who come in and talk about issues and policies, a new format that will kick into the program as far as Straight Talk is concerned. So look forward to that. We are just trying to get a confirmation from a party, and that is expected to happen tonight. We should be ready to go with that one from 7 o'clock tomorrow night. But tonight we have the man in charge of the 2014 general elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem, in studio. I know you have been really busy, Mr. Saneem, but thank you very much for accepting this invitation.
Thank you, Vijay. I think this also gives me an opportunity to impart the latest happenings of elections to all the listeners.
Thank you very much. The numbers you can call on to register your questions are 9923351, 9923352, 773-4766, and 773-0693. You can also call us on 3314-766. We'll be taking your calls as we go through and discuss the issues relating to the 2014 general elections. Election day confirmed, polling day confirmed for September 17th. One day polling, Mr. Saneem. Preparations all on track so far?
We are very busy with our preparations at the moment, Vijay. We have a plan. As I said earlier, we had a plan from April. And we are trying to ensure that we are on target in terms of our little project, and we hope to achieve everything on time. So far, we have managed to get things done on time, and as an example today, the ballot paper printing, that is on schedule as well. So things are still getting into place, but yes, we are working very hard towards that.
I've noticed that the timelines that you had said, that you had announced, that you are making them, you're even hitting them before you hit the timeline. So definitely you've got some sort of schedule to ensure, maybe a challenge that you're putting for yourself and your team to ensure that you reach that target before time?
We have a very hard-working team, and one of the things that we have in place is that we have sounders, alarms ticking off as soon as we know something is nearby. And that has helped us get organized, and we work with each other, we complement each other's work, and we get to the targets as and when we expect it to be. So all in one, the team is working very hard, and we're working very hard to get the project completed on time.
What's your total workforce at the moment, and how much funding are you working with to ensure that you deliver credible and free and fair elections?
We are grateful for the funding that we have, and we have at the moment in the office approximately 150 to 200 staff working, and then we have about 100 staff on the field at any point in time. So with that number, we're trying to make sure that all the machinery works in place.
And the funding? What is the total funding?
The initial funding was provided by the government of $15 million. We have received the first tranche of funding from Papua New Guinea. And there has been other funds provided by other donor countries such as Turkey, China, Japan, and also India. And they've also provided in-kind support as well. Australia and New Zealand are classic examples. They've been providing a lot of technical support. The European Union has also been funding the training of the polling day workers and presiding officers. So we are working well within the funding, and we still have funds to continue to do this, yes.
So what is the total value of the funding in cash in kind?
We would, on an estimate, around $21 million or $23 million in cash. And there is a lot of, there are some purchases that were provided for through the funding. So in kind would be another about $2 million.
Now, you have assistance of experts from Australia, New Zealand, and some other countries. What type of expertise have they brought into the elections office?
Fiji has had this system where the elections office was only populated at the time elections was near, and thereafter everybody went back to wherever they came from. So the elections office at one point in time had a total staff cadre of six. That meant that there was no capacity building that was happening around elections. And as such, if you take an example, the Australian Electoral Commission, it continues to operate throughout the year. And it continues from election to election. They do capacity building, they do improvement of processes, they do all these things that Fiji didn't do. And in that regard, the experts that are working with us, they have got about 30 years, 29 years experience in electoral areas. And they bring to us experiences and the good practices, the practices that didn't work or the practices that might not work. And that is what we need. And with those experiences, we are able to efficiently understand the scenario in front of us and then manage that.
Give us some experiences where you wouldn't have thought of that if these experts were not in the elections office.
Well, one example would be the ballot paper. If you would see the ballot paper for this year's election, it has numbers on it. Now, ideally, if you want to know, you'd put a ballot paper, say, let's just fold it and put it in an envelope and send it. But with the electoral experience, one of the advisors told us, when you fold the ballot paper, you must ensure that the fold doesn't happen on top of any of the numbers. Because that would, in one way, you can infer that that number is not preferred. So it's very sensitive issues like those that comes with experience that the experts are bringing in. And with that example, the postal vote envelopes that are there with the foldings that are done on the ballot paper for the postal vote, you will find that it has been clinically done so that no number is actually has a fold on it. The fold happens on blank areas. So that's an example for you.
You're on Straight Talk tonight with the Supervisor of Elections, Mohammed Saneem, the man in charge of the 2014 general elections, one-day voting, and of course, first time ever, the new electoral system that we will be using during this election. So a lot of questions coming through. Keep calling in. We will be taking some questions in the next few minutes. The number again, 3314766. Now, the allocation of polling stations is different in this year's election compared to last year. Please explain the rationale behind this move.
There is when it becomes a one-day election, pulled back from 7 days, the immediate consideration is that there will be a bulk of voters. And say, for example, an example that I use most of the time is the Rishikul school, which had around 2,400 voters. If these 2,400 voters were to vote in over a period of 7 days, they would have come one day, there was a big line, they would come the next day, the next day, the next day. But in this system, they have only one day. So when they come to vote, it is critical that as the election management body, we ensure that they are all able to vote within that time frame that is being given. And to that regard, we have created polling stations within the venues. So what that means is that at Rishikul school, where we use the main hall, we will now use several classrooms. And there will be, instead of one stream, there will be six streams. And one of the other things that we have tried to apply practically is not more than 500 voters. So with that, in a 10.5-hour day for polling, provided we put five voting screens, that means five people vote at any one point in time, and a voter gets an average 6.4 minutes, but there is no specific restriction. That's just a mathematical analysis of how much time the person would get, but there is no specific restriction. You can take longer. An informed voter can vote quicker, but a person who wishes to take his or her time at the booth to decide, they are welcome to do so. So It's not that you have only 2 minutes or 4 minutes or 6 minutes. You have the time to vote, as long as you don't stand there for 2 hours. Otherwise, we will come and ask you, is there a problem with this?
Now, just talking about that, six classrooms, how many screens in each classroom?
Five
screens in each classroom running at the from 7:30 a.m. to 6 p.m.
Yes.
on polling day. Now, we've got a question from Bridja Nand in Nosori. Good evening, Bridja.
Mr. Saneem, can you please extend the date for the win for the people when the won? Because we are from Bisama Peter Road, we have to go to Naslai. We can't go to Bisama Sarnatan Primary School. That's the nearest polling station for us. Thank you.
Thank you. One of the other things that has happened in this is that we have to allocate voters to polling stations. And we had to undertake this exercise. And following the exercise, it has been found that a lot of people had initially registered thinking that they might be at work and all this. So the new considerations, which is that it's a public holiday. So we have had to put a close on this, because following the close, the issue of the written close of registrations, we've had to, at some point in time, we have to bring finality to the roll. And that has happened in terms of the change in polling venues. We had to close it on 20th August. And following that, we are now in the process of finalizing the roll. Now, what
so
the gentleman raised...
what happens to these people?
They will only be able to vote where they have been registered or assigned. And in this case, I think we gave approximately 3 weeks. We set up a system where you text on 545, you get the opportunity to see where you are currently assigned, and then you can apply for a change by simply filling out a form telling us your preferred venue, and we will assign you there. And that closed on the 20th of August, and unfortunately, the person who is not assigned, not applied for a change, we cannot extend any further.
Did you get a lot of changes coming through?
We have been doing changes. It might be around 6,000 to 7,000, and we are still getting, we are still doing the data entry into that, but it has closed on 20th of August.
For those people who had made the applications for the change, have they already received the confirmation that your change is accepted and it will be done, and they will vote at the new polling station, whichever polling station they had given?
We worked on the principle that as a person applies for a change, it is approved. So the final roll, once we announce it coming out, the person will then be able to check whether I have been moved or not. Moving a person, 6,000 people, takes a lot of time in the system, because we have to certify. The system doesn't allow you to move a person directly. We have to fulfill certain requirements in the system to give explanation, and that is being done right now. We've got a team of people working on it, and once the roll is finalized, because when you apply, the form at the bottom has a small chit. You also keep a record of where you applied for a change. So if that doesn't happen, the person can call 545 and we will immediately look into it. But as it is, every application has been accepted.
So when will the final roll be out with all the changes?
That is a good question, because we have closed postal vote applications today at 6 o'clock. And near 6 o'clock, we started receiving hundreds and hundreds of applications.
What do you do with that?
Well, we will process the applications that we receive at the time. And we will then have to create, in every voter list for every polling station, we will have to mark any person who has applied for a postal vote. So the system, because it's an electronic system, it's easier to do that. We don't have to manually find the voter list and mark it. And the electronic voter registration system will flag that voter as a postal voter. And once that is all done, we will be able to release the final roll.
Now, I asked this question because in previous elections, people turn up at polling stations and then names do not appear in the roll, and they start arguing that I had registered and my name is not here and I want to vote. What are you trying to do to ensure that that does not happen?
Simple solution is to SMS your EVR number to 545.
They have to do it now.
You can do it now. You can do it on 16 September. You can do it on 17 September. But the sooner you do it, the sooner you will know where your venue is.
but they cannot change their polling station anymore.
That is not permissible anymore.
Okay, so wherever you are registered, for the people listening out there, that is your place to vote, and you cannot change it anymore because the deadline has expired. Now, talking about deadlines, I noticed that voter registration, as voter registrations were growing, and you kept talking about people to come out and register to vote, of course, you had numbers coming through towards the last few days, but that last hour when... you were standing near MHCC and there was definitely more than 1,000 people at about 5:45. Closing time was at about 6 p.m. You're getting that last minute rush again tonight for the application for postal voting.
Yes.
How are you dealing with it, and what is your message to the people?
Generally, from the 4th of August events, we have taken into consideration certain lessons as the FEO, and those are the lessons that we are implementing, such as we will ensure that we are available and we are more accessible. So on 4th of August, just around MHCC, we created another one at Terry Work, and then we created another station at Tapu City, and then we also expanded across to the EV Triangle. So just for Suva as an example, we were very quick to be able to accommodate the increase in demand, and we were able to split the queues and send people to the next station to give them the opportunity to register. Same here for the postal vote applications. As more were coming, our offices were all open until 6 o'clock, and the applications that were sent through email are on the server, registered at Gmail server at 6, so those will be all approved and will actually be considered actually. So one other thing that arises from this is that on 17th of September, the person who is last in the line at 6 o'clock, that's where the assistant presiding officer will go and stand with the last person. Any person who comes after that will not be able to vote.
So that's a clear instruction from you, and that's according to the law. Now,
yes.
Now just talking about that, because some people may be thinking, oh, we haven't been given a chance. And as you've said, that you have given the chance, and that people are not turning up before the deadline.
Yes.
The issue of you having to follow the deadline, why is it so necessary?
Elections is a very prescriptive process. There are several things in elections that need to happen in order for the entire process to be accomplished. And one of those things, and all of those things actually require you, us, to follow strict deadlines. Now, if we continue to allow people to vote after 6 p.m., they will delay the count. The other factor would be, it would be unfair to those who may not be allowed to vote at 6 p.m. because suddenly the presiding officer followed the law and said no more. But if we continue to extend deadlines, then we will have to have two-day, three-day elections because people will still take time. The whole process needs to be done within the time frame in order for us to get the results on time and also for the results to be used to allocate seats.
Thank you very much. You're on Straight Talk with our guest tonight, the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem. You can call us on 3314766 if you have any questions for the Supervisor of Elections in relation to the elections that he is conducting, to ensure that you get all the answers tonight and you are well versed with everything. 20 days to go for that big day, for polling day. Of course, we've got questions coming through. Malesh from Suva. Malesh, good evening.
My question is that I think I heard over the news that there's a pre-polling day for essential service providers like police, doctors, and also I heard about the public service vehicle drivers, and as it was announced, there should be no hindrance to the public transport on the polling day. How far is it true?
Let me first explain that doctors and nurses have been advised to apply for a postal vote. We will not be able to conduct a pre-poll exercise inside a hospital. This is risky in terms of we will pull doctors and nurses off the shift. It's also risky because crowds of people in a hospital, some may be sick, that would create a trouble. So they have all been advised to apply for a postal vote. We have sent out this information to the Ministry of Health and they have been liaising with their staff. As for police and other essential services such as firemen, they have also been informed to apply for a postal vote. And we have sent out the forms. So pre-polling is basically for people, for the prisons department, correction services, the military, they are applying, and also for transport operators, the drivers, they've been invited to apply for postal. Because
but they had to apply. If they didn't apply, they will not get that option.
It's the decree requires a person to apply, so we've asked them to apply.
Now, Navendra Kumar from Nandi has a question. Navendra, good evening.
My name is Navendra Kumar. I lost my card. I went to do the voting, but no card. I got no card. Which place I going to make the card? All the places, they close the place to make the card.
But people who have lost their cards, what is the option they have at the moment to get the new card?
You can replace your card.
Right.
Card replacement goes up until 16th of September. And if the offices are open, you can go and get your card replaced. If you are in Nandi, maybe the Nandi airport office. Yes.
Now, with the cards, you're getting a lot of that? People losing their cards coming over? I have been to the elections office. Every time I've been there, they've asked me where should I go to go and get my replacement. So definitely getting a lot of requests like that?
Yes. we are very near to elections. So everybody who cannot find their card is taking the first step to come and get a replacement done. That is very encouraging because the person then doesn't have to undergo additional questions to be able to vote. Same note, it's a bit alarming that so many people are losing their cards.
What are the numbers like?
I'm sorry, I can't give you the numbers offhand, but we receive quite a lot.
Numbers you can call 3313 966 9923 351 9923 352 7734766 and 7730693. If you have any questions for the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem, we'll take a short break and we'll be right back after that.
Welcome back to Straight Talk with Vijay Narayan, brought to you by Bonwell.
Good evening. Tonight our in-studio guest is the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem. If you have any questions regarding the 2014 general elections, he will be ready to take your questions. We have a question from Raki Raki, a taxi operator by the name of Ashwin. Good evening, Ashwin.
Good evening, Mr. Saneem. I would like to ask a question. That the day of the polling is on September 17th. It is a public holiday. What about if anybody wants to hire the cab? Like we are the taxi operators, if anybody wants to hire the taxi to go for the polling station to give the vote, so we have to ask for permission to drive or not? Thank you, sir.
The Electoral Commission has been having meetings in this regard with the Ministry of Transport, also with the LTA and stakeholders such as the Fiji Taxi Association. And I believe the current stand is that on that day, public transport will operate as normal. So you can provide the service.
Thank you very much. Now, going on to ballot papers, you've said that the ballot paper printing should finish by tonight. Can you please confirm for the listeners the total number of registered voters for next month's election and how many ballot papers have been printed?
Our figures stand at 590,982. And the total number of ballot papers that we are estimating to print is 715,715. The ballot papers for polling day will be printed and then we will compile them into a stubs of 50. So you will have a book of 50 ballot papers and we will have those sent in multiples as per the requirements in the number of voters per polling station to each polling station.
Now, what's the rationale behind printing the extra ballot papers?
As I explained, in a polling station that has got, say for example, 113 voters 113. For that polling station, we will have to then send 3 books. And that polling station will have an extra of approximately 37 ballot papers. Now that 37, we can't then print from there and put somewhere else to be used. We can't take that risk. So the extras will have to be accounted
You're
for.
You're talking about risk. Why, of course, you did your risk assessment. Where's the risk? What is the risk there?
One thing that we don't want to do in this election is to move ballot papers around after it has been opened in a polling station.
Right.
On a worst case scenario, a presiding officer may request for a transfer of ballot papers, but that has to be inspected and authorized by both presiding officers. But what we don't want to do is say, oh, we are running short here, can the other polling station supply? That way there won't be any accountability. At the end of the day, the reconciliation will not match, because we might run extra ballot papers or we might run short ballot papers. And that is something that we do not want. And in the planning process, we have got a very rigorous accountability system where we are going to ensure that the number of ballot papers supplied to a polling station reconciled at the end of the day. If there is shorts or if there is extras, the presiding officer will have to give a very good explanation.
Now, statistically, how many ballot papers are spoiled and voters ask for another ballot paper? Statistically, in Fiji, maybe you've got experts from Australia, New Zealand, but what would be the statistic like? What percentage of the total voters would have that issue?
We are encouraging voters to actually ask for a replacement. And telling from Fiji's experience, I cannot give you any statistics on that. But we are actually encouraging a person to ask for one replacement that person is entitled to, because the vote has to be counted and that has to be a valid vote. So the person, if they have made a mistake, we are encouraging voters to step up and ask for a replacement, not to feel shy or not to feel that, oh, that they will be marginalized or penalized for asking for replacement. It's actually something we are promoting, that if you've made a mistake, you can ask for a replacement.
One replacement.
Rather than marking an invalid ballot paper and dropping it in the box.
Now, if somebody marks a certain number and then decides, oh, I don't want that number, what happens then?
Well, if you have not dropped your ballot paper in the ballot box, you can ask for a replacement.
What
and
happens
the presiding
to the other
officer,
ballot paper?
Presiding officer will cancel the ballot paper and write on it, it is returned. And after that is done, the presiding officer is going to give you another ballot paper. But that will be the final ballot paper you get. However, you cannot ask for a ballot paper after you have dropped it in the ballot box.
That's it.
That's it.
Now, John from Somambula has a question. John, good evening.
I want to know whether to tick or circle or cross on my candidate number. And I also wanted to know whether when we do either of the three, if they say the tick goes outside the box or the circle goes outside the box, does it become invalid or not? Thank you.
The option is there for you. Either you circle or tick or cross. You can't do all three. You can do only one. And if you, in your nervousness of marking the ballot paper, the tick goes outside or the cross comes a little outside or the circle is a little outside the box, at the time of the counting, the presiding officers have been trained to actually try and determine the intention of the voter. So if the center of the cross is on a number, it is reasonable to understand that the person intended that number to be the chosen number. So that is how the presiding officers have been trained. And in their manual, we have given them some samples. And the samples are based on an opinion we've sought from the Solicitor General's office. And they will then be able to refer those examples from the book and try and ascertain the intention of the voter.
Our in-studio guest tonight on Straight Talk is the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem. You can call him on 3314766 if you have any questions. Now, how many people have applied for postal voting? Have you got a sort of an estimated number? And please explain who qualifies for postal voting and how this works.
As at 4 p.m., we had about approximately 7,000 plus people. And I cannot tell you the figures now because they would still be compiling the applications that have been received. The application was available to any person who was either due to sickness or infirmity unable to travel to the polling station, or if the person was unable to travel to polling station due to religious beliefs, disallowing the person to go to the polling station on 17th of September, or if the person was incarcerated in the remand, or if the person was unable to travel due to work commitments, or the person was incapable due to sickness or infirmity. So that was what was there, and most importantly, if the person is not in Fiji or will not be in Fiji on the day of elections.
The process of postal voting, how do they go about voting?
What happens is that it's going to happen tomorrow, we're going to start packing DHL envelopes. We put out a tender and we are going to work with DHL, and for all the postal vote applications, we are going to send it out through DHL. And it will be sent tomorrow. We are going to start packing. We will insert in a DHL envelope. When a person will receive it, they will receive a transmission envelope, a return envelope, a secret envelope, a ballot paper, a national candidates list in the form of a voter instruction booklet, and they will also get the contacts of the nearest DHL office. So what the person has to do is follow the instructions on the pamphlets to mark their ballot paper, fold it, put it inside the secret envelope, seal the secret envelope. And then the person has to put the secret envelope...
How secret is the envelope?
It's an ordinary envelope labeled secret envelope to give instructions to any of my staff on the day of opening the ballot, the return envelopes, that this envelope is not to be opened until 6 p.m. So it's called a secret envelope because it's got secret content in it.
Now, in relation to that, Mr. Saneem, there's some questions raised by some people that some of these people, if they do apply for postal ballot and it is sent to them, somebody else in their family vote on their behalf.
Yes.
Of course, that raises a question on whether this can be done or not. Mm-hmm. What is your stand on that?
Well, what I was trying to finish earlier was that actually when you get the ballot paper in the secret envelope, you fill it, pack it into another envelope which is called the transmission envelope, and you fill out the details of the person who had applied for postal vote. So that is where you put in the signature of the person as well as all the other EVR details and residential details. That is packed into an envelope called the transmission envelope, and then the person can call DHL to come and collect that envelope, send it to us. When we receive it, we, on 17th of September, post that, we will open the transmission envelope, and inside that, sorry, we will open the return envelope, and in the transmission envelope will be all the details of the person. We will use those details and we will check it with the details submitted at the time of application. So the first thing we'll check is whether the signature matches. If the signature matches, then we will proceed to continue to verify. If the signature doesn't match, we will send it to quarantine. Then we will try and ascertain other details, because we do not want it to be a case where the person gets it all there and packs it and signs and off sends it back. The person has to have the exact signature as per the application. And the security built in the application is that the person has to give a statutory declaration. So the signature is before a Justice of Peace of Commissioner right. 4. So with that signature, we verify the signature on the transmission envelope. After that, once that has passed, that yes, it's an accurate signature, then we will open the transmission envelope and take out the secret envelope, which will be then used for counting then the votes. So that's there. Although you are right, there will exist a possibility that with postal vote applications, the person's vote may not be a secret because it's available, it's a vulnerable vote.
Right.
But that is how postal votes operate. If a person applies for postal vote, it is the responsibility of the person to ensure the secrecy of the ballot. If the person comes to a polling station to vote, FEO is to ensure the secrecy of the ballot. But when you ask for the ballot paper to be sent to you, you are responsible for it entirely.
We have a call from Nakashi Vinesh. Good evening.
Okay. When we're going to go to the polling station, right, we're going to get the ballot papers, right, to tick or cross or circle, right? But before that, we're going to get the symbol of the person and the name and the number, right? But beside the number, there is no party's name or party's symbol. So how can we know that he is representing that party and who is representing that party?
Mr. Saneem?
That question can be answered in this way. in the election, you will be voting for a candidate, and you will vote for only one person, and the vote that's given to the candidate then contributes to the vote for the party. So what has happened is that we did the draw on the 23rd of August, and anticipated with that we started publishing the numbers of everybody after the court case. This has allowed you at least given at least one advance day for people to know this. Now, if you want to know what number your candidate has, you will be able to find that on our website. We will be sending out multiple publications. You can check that there, and then you will know the number of your candidate. Because at the end of the day, you will be voting for the candidate only.
But you can't put party names in the candidate's list anyway. The decree does not allow you.
That's not allowed in the decree, true.
So even if you wanted to do that, the decree stops you from doing that.
The Fijian Elections Office will implement the decree, and that is the stand that we have taken, yes.
Now, for pre-polling, how many people are expected to have the pre-polling process?
A rough estimate, about 50,000. But we will be able to confirm some figures shortly after the release of the final voter list.
So around 50,000 pre-polling. Yes. And which areas have been allocated for pre-polling?
There are various areas that we have identified for pre-polling. One of the approaches that we have taken is a practical approach. The remoteness of the area, the accessibility to the area, and also the number of people living in that area who are registered as voters. So one thing that would happen before was that, say in a road, there are three villages. One is a big village and two small ones. Previously, if election were to happen there, the small villages would travel to the big village and they vote in the big village. We have actually this time split it. We are actually going to the small villages and we'll conduct polling in the small villages. But then the perception arises, why the two small villages and not the big one? So to clear the air on that, we will be doing pre-polling in all three.
Right.
So that it doesn't happen that, oh, maybe because that village supports that party, that's why they did it there, to give them less time to campaign, whereas this one supports that party, so that we don't want to get involved in politics. We are an apolitical organization. We have made a choice to actually do a pre-poll in all three villages for the sake of transparency and also to allow equal access.
Transportation of those ballot papers.
Yes.
How will you do that?
Ballot paper transportation will be undertaken under huge security.
Who will be involved in the security team?
Firstly, the ballot papers are the responsibility of the presiding officer. So that person has to be there. The vehicle will also have a police officer present in them. We have organized with the Fiji Police Force, and we are thankful for the arrangements that they have been making with us. And we will have escorts as well, where necessary. So if there is one ballot box in a vehicle going up the hill somewhere, and there is a police officer inside the vehicle, and he's got the ballot box near him, not necessary, but if there is a transport, say from Suva to Lotoka, the ballot papers are being transported, we will organize for security.
And observers? You'll have observers during the pre-polling period too?
Yes, we have been having meetings with observers, and they have also stated their intention to actually be present during pre-polling, and they are organizing their own plans as to how they will conduct the monitoring exercise.
What about political parties?
They are also invited. Political parties can have their polling agents present at the pre-polling station. They can also follow the vehicle carrying ballot papers. But we can't carry anybody with us.
That's right.
But they have to find their own.
And they cannot go right inside the voting venue.
They can go inside the voting venue, but they can't go to the voting screen. In this election, a polling agent is entitled to be inside a polling station during voting, during counting as well.
Have political parties applied to have that access?
In fact, the Fijian Elections Office conducted polling agents trainer workshop for political parties, and we have trained the trainers on how to train their polling agents who will be conducting the polling agent work on election day. And the parties have been coming forth. They have all come, and except for one, and that will be tomorrow. The polling agent training ensures that the polling agents understand what the system is, what the procedures are, and that's when they will be able to provide the checks and balance process that we are critically looking for.
What type of numbers are we looking at as far as political parties are concerned? How many numbers or how many number of people are they saying that they will send through to all these pre-polling venues?
Well, approximately 1,400 polling stations might be operational on 17th of September, and political parties may choose to put at least one agent in each. So that would be...
About pre-polling.
Pre-polling, if they decide they wish to put a polling agent, they can do so. Yes, about 400 polling stations.
400 polling stations. And these are pre-polling, as you said, these are remote areas. We're looking at interior of Viti level?
Yes.
Interior of Vanua level?
Interior of Viti level, some coastline areas of Viti level which don't have road access or proper road access,
right.
Determined by river tide and all
right.
this. Similarly, for Vanua level, Undu Point, there's a place where you have to go, there's a creek you have to cross. There's no bridge over it. Three creeks actually, so those are all pre-polled.
And Eastern Division, Kandavu, Lomai Viti?
Kandavu, not exactly. Kandavu is quite well established. We are able to run polling stations there. But Lomai Viti and Lau groups, yes, we will be doing pre-polling. And we've got the scheduled out, yes.
So for Kandavu, they vote on September 17th?
There would be. It would be in the notice of poll. Unfortunately, I cannot offhand recall that, yes.
So at this point in time, I noticed the dates. Pre-polling will be held from September 3rd, which
yes.
is next Wednesday,
yes.
to September 15th.
Yes.
That's right. Now, we have a question from Khan in Lambasa. Good evening, Khan.
The information that we text to 545, and then we receive the message, and it says, please call 545. And I'm trying from long time to call 545. Only it says the number is not working, eh?
Thank you. We will register that as a complaint because we have outsourced our call center to a reputable company, and definitely they will be able to check as to why that response was given.
Thank you very much. Chandrika from Nosori has a question for the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem. Good evening, Chandrika.
He became Minister for Elections, and PS for Justice Department became Supervisor of Elections. Do you believe that these elections will be having integrity and transparency?
Mr. Saneem.
I think we got part of the question, but in terms of the Fijian Elections Office, we have a very strong mission statement, and we are bound by a very, very, very strong... a code of conduct as well, which is drafted by the Electoral Commission. And I can assure you that we are implementing all strict measures in terms of transparency and accountability. And we look forward to trying to continue to maintain the transparency and integrity of the process.
Now, Mr. Saneem, the People's Democratic Party leader, Mr. Felix Anthony, has raised concerns on why there is pre-polling for the military and the police. Can you please explain why that a decision was taken for both the military and the police?
The electoral decree, first and foremost, provides for pre-polling for disciplined forces. And we have implemented the electoral decree for that. And that is simply the reason why.
You need the police to be out and about, you had earlier said?
Yes, for police, we've actually asked for police to apply for postal vote. That is because... on 17th of September, if a police officer is standing in a line, in a queue to vote, we need that person to in fact be able to provide security. So it would defeat the purpose if the person would be hesitant, either choose between getting to vote or actually providing security. And we do not want to put any of the police officers in such a situation. And to that end, we informed the police to be able to apply for a postal vote, and they did. And they will be voting in advance so that they are available to provide the security that they actually wish to do so, yeah.
Same thing with the military?
For the military, these are personnel in barracks, and there are disciplined forces, and we have allowed for pre-polling because we wouldn't want to have all of them come out of their barracks to go to their residential addresses and conduct to take part in voting. So that is why we are doing it at the venue that they are at.
Now, have you been speaking to these parties? Because we have been attending some of the campaign meetings, and information is being given out to people out there that this is being done because those votes will be counted first so that people can find out which way the disciplined services, the members of the disciplined forces are voting. Can you please clarify that for everyone listening out there to ensure that you clear all doubts about that on when these votes will be counted?
Vijay, I think the misconception here is created because parties do not understand the way in which the electoral decree has designed this. All votes cast before 17th of September will be counted after the close of polls on 17th of September. That's after 6 p.m. on 17th of September. and we will have all these ballot papers and ballot boxes returned, safely secured under police guard until that date.
An interesting issue there. Why are these parties raising that issue? You said maybe they're misinformed or do not understand the decree. Have all the parties and their representatives been coming to your briefings to find out how these processes are working?
We have had regular briefings about the process with the parties, and we have maintained a lot of communications with the parties, and we have always kept an open door policy in case they had any questions or queries. All of the parties are welcome to write to us for clarifications. Most of them do most of the time, and we are happy to clarify these things. Should they have any misunderstanding, it would be wiser not to mislead the public 20 days away from elections, but to actually seek clarifications from the office before they make such statements.
So there you go. If you went to a campaign meeting and you were told that the votes will be counted first as far as the pre-poll votes are concerned, that is not happening. Right here on Straight Talk, Mr. Saneem has confirmed it was in the decree. We had also raised this issue when it was raised in a PDP campaign meeting that why is this being done, that votes had to be counted earlier. That is not happening. We move on to the next question. Samson from Deumba, good evening.
Okay, my question is, what if on the 16th of September I get sick and I get admitted to the hospital? How do I go about my voting? Or could it happen to any other person? Thank you.
Thank you, very valid question. The way to answer this question would be to say, unfortunately, you may not be able to vote. A person will only be able to vote at the polling station he or she has been assigned to. Another practical way to approach this question is that if you were admitted to hospital, I would prefer that you get the right treatment first, because your health is more important. If a person is in a hospital, they have been given a shot and they are sleeping, we do not anticipate that they will be able to cast a vote in their right mind if they have they are on sleeping medicines. So it is something that is there, yes, it's a risk, and it's an unfortunate risk, but if you are not able to attend to your polling station on election day and you have not applied for postal voting, you may not be able to vote. So but there is no fine.
So if you're in hospital, you cannot vote?
Well, unless you are able to make it to the polling station. The way to vote would be to come to your polling station. So that's the way I would like to answer the question.
Ramesh from Lotoka, good evening. Your question, please.
My first question is, what will be the size of the ballot paper? A3, A4?
A3.
What will be the size? And the second one is, whether the numbers will appear in order like 135, 136, 137 that way?
Yes.
Or will they be mixed or jumbled numbers?
Thank you. The numbers will appear in sequence, 135, and it will go down to 154, and then 155 to 174. And it will not be mixed or jumbled. The candidate book that you will get, the voter instruction booklet, that will also have the names, numbers, and photographs of candidates in sequential order of numbers starting 135, 136 going on.
The Supervisor of Elections, the man in charge of the 2014 general elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem, is our in-studio guest tonight. If you have any questions regarding the elections, you can call him on 3314766. We are on Straight Talk. We'll take a short break and we'll be right back.
Straight Talk with Vijay Narayan, brought to you by Bonwell.
Good evening. Our in-studio guest tonight is the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem, and you can call us on 3314766 if you have any questions. Paul from Rewa Street, good evening.
Before, they used to do the electronic voting, but now why they have changed to this ballot paper, man? Because starting they were saying that they will do the electronic voting, electronic voting, now they have changed to the ballot papers. Thank you.
Thank you. I just referred to the electoral decree. The electoral decree prescribes that voting will be done by ballot and not electronic. The registration is electronic, voter registration. However, the voting is by ballot.
You can't make the decision to go electronic anyway.
No.
Now, observers involved in this process, of course, they have arrived. They've said about observers from about 14 countries and co-led by Australia, Papua New Guinea. They have started off the process by, I believe, they were there from the nomination process. How much access do they have?
The observers began their work at close of nomination. They were there to view the closing of nomination, and we have been in frequent contact straight after. Andrew and his team are very approachable. They are also very well communicating with us. You know, the communication channels are quite simple, and we have been accrediting observers daily, and the approvals from the government are very quick and timely as well to facilitate the process. And we've been doing this since the first day they arrived, and we are working with them. They have their own itinerary. They have got open access. There's simple courtesy calls sometimes that are made, but just like the ballot paper printing today, we took the observers across, showed them, gave them a tour of the whole facility, and we are also doing the same in all the other aspects of elections with them.
Now, Nirmal from Nasinu has called. Good evening, Nirmal, and thank you for your question. Nirmal's question is, if Mr. Saneem gets sick for some reason on election day, who will replace him?
This is where, as I say, elections is run by a team of good people, and any person who gets sick can be replaced and will be able to perform the task, and that's how we'll operate. We are also operating on the presumption that I don't get sick as well.
We hope you don't. On the issue of transport, some people have asked that question, public transport. So you've said, and I believe that it has been decreed already, public transport will be operating as normal on September 17?
Sorry, if I may correct you, it's not yet decreed. It is something that the Electoral Commission has had discussions with the relevant stakeholders, and positive vibes have come out from that discussion, and we look forward to cementing that shortly.
What is the delay?
Well, the stakeholders have gone back. We're waiting for finalization, or in terms of that formal confirmation.
For people sitting out there wondering whether there will be public transport, how long do they have to wait before they find out?
Well, it has been agreed that public transport will be made available. So as to say whether it is formalized yet or not, it has not yet been formalized, but there is an agreement. It will be available.
Now, under the electoral decree, political parties cannot pick up or drop off people to or from polling stations. This is something new, because that was a process that was undertaken for years, many years. How will you monitor this if some parties continue to do that?
The enforcement part of the decree is to be done by police and fire kick. And if we find any probable breach of the decree, will refer it to police and fire kick.
So what happens to those vehicles that have stickers or political party symbols on them and they're operating on that day?
Well, my view would be that they need to take it out, but it's subject to their own interpretation of their law.
So at this point in time, if you have any political party symbols on the day of voting, it's safer for them not to have it on that day?
Well, if it counts as campaign, they can't do any campaign within the 300 meter boundary, and they can't do any media campaign within the 48 hour period. Aside from that, as I said, the person has to get his own legal advice as to how it will operate, because we are not the enforcement authority and we cannot guarantee how it will be enforced.
Now, we have another question. Have you received applications from parties for their representatives to be at polling stations on the day of polling? This is September 17th. You talked about they can go pre-polling if they wish. Have you received all those applications? Surely you would have some deadlines in place to ensure that their application forms are in time. Have they done that?
Under the electoral decree, a party agent is appointed by a party and accredited by the presiding officer. So what we have generated is a form that the party has to fill on its own letterhead, and it's an authorization appointment letter of polling agent, and the person is to produce that form together with a driver's license or any photo ID VR card to the presiding officer, and the presiding officer will get the person to sign on the declaration, and the person will be accredited.
Okay, and when do they have to lodge in their applications?
It can be on the day.
On the day?
Yes.
So how many, do you have a limit on the number of political parties or how many representatives they can send to a polling station?
It's not per party, it is more to do with the venue. So if it's a large enough venue, you could have at least, you could have one representative at the most from each party or independent candidate. Or if it's a small venue, then the presiding officer might have to do a bit of crowd control and at any point in time decide as to how many people are allowed in.
Sarema from Nosori has a question. Good evening, Sarema.
Hello, I just wanted to know, like, what happens to those who are staying in the remote areas if they do not have the access to the internet? How will they be able to know of their candidate's number? Thank you.
We are going to undertake an exercise of in which we are going to distribute the voter instruction booklet that has the numbers of the candidates on a wide scale. And that exercise will begin sometimes from tomorrow. And we will be targeting the remote areas which are subject to pre-poll first. And then we will continue with the urban areas which are already in access to a lot of means of advertising.
Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem, is on Straight Talk tonight. You can call on 3314-766 to take any questions. 20 days to go for the general election, September 17th. But pre-polling starts from next Wednesday, the 3rd of September. Please stay listening. We will soon start broadcasting the different polling, pre-polling venues for you. Stay listening to find out your pre-polling venue and then find out the date that voting, pre-polling will take place at your village or community hall and other issues that you need to find out. We will definitely have that information running as early as maybe from tomorrow morning. And now, Mr. Saneem, what are you doing to ensure that we have a high voter turnout? We've got a public holiday. We've got a lot of new voters. And voting is not compulsory. What are some of the strategies that you have in place to ensure that you have a high voter turnout in this election?
One of the important things, Vijay, is that we're working from figures from registration, which is also voluntary. And we have achieved 590,000 plus voters who have registered. That in itself is a very high encouragement to voters to say that 590,000 did register, how many of us are actually going to vote. And it also is a significant step to say that there are 590,000 people who have voluntarily stepped up to register. When we began registration, we estimated 600 to 620,000 voters. So we have crossed the 95% mark. If you take the 600,000, I think we're 97%. Or 620,000 mark, then it's over 94%. So on a voluntary registration system, reaching that benchmark is great because Australia, with its compulsory registration, has 91%, 92%. So in this election, from our own visits to all these areas, we see a lot of interest. And that interest is what we are capitalizing on. People are actually stepping up themselves and saying, I need to vote. This is how I have to do it. And from the questions we also assume, we are also able to understand that there is an interest. That is why a person is saying, this is where my venue is. What do I do to get there? Where is this? And in addition to that, I think people in Fiji have always had this this urge that they should vote. I think they have been in the trend that they have been voting and it is actually a very positive thing. Towards the next 2 weeks, we are going to run special programs to encourage voters to vote, and you will get to see what we have in store.
Now, Mr. Saneem, for the benefit of listeners, can you please clarify why you are taking legal advice from the Solicitor General's office? The Electoral Commission said that it decided to get advice from lawyers in New Zealand last week due to the controversy surrounding the issues relating to appeals and objections. The PDP and NFP have come out with statements which have been covered by some media outlets where the parties have questioned why you are getting legal advice from the Solicitor General. Minister for Elections has said publicly, Mr. Ayaz Syed Kayum, that the Electoral Commission should have sought legal advice from the Solicitor General. As he says, the law is quite specific that the Commission must make a decision on appeals and objections in relation to candidate nominations within 3 days. He said that it is really a pity that the Electoral Commission did not see fit to get an opinion from the Solicitor General, who provides independent opinion. But then he says that they went overseas to get two legal counsels in New Zealand to get an opinion. Now, there was a difference in opinion on the deadline for the decision on the appeals and objections. We ended up in court. The court had to make a determination on the matter. Can you please clarify why you were taking advice from the SG's office? And secondly, your responsibilities are clearly stated in the electoral decree. If the Electoral Commission does something that you need clarification on, who do you get your advice from? Please comment on this.
Vijay, one of the important things that one must remember is that the Solicitor General's office is an independent legal office that provides assistance in terms of legal interpretation, legal advice. And as the Fijian Elections Office, we opted to, as a supervisor of elections, I opted to get legal advice from the Solicitor General himself on issues related to the electoral decree. It is also important to understand that the Solicitor General's office is involved in the drafting of decrees, so they would be more familiar with what the intention was, and they'd be more familiar with how the interpretation is to be. And that is why I took a very practical approach. I took advice from the Solicitor General's office. The Constitution allows it. Any statutory body wishes to take legal advice from the Solicitor General's office can do so, and that's what we did. When I sought legal advice from the Solicitor General's office, he was willing and he gave the legal advice. We went up to court, and the court was also of the same view that I was correct in obtaining legal advice from the Solicitor General's office. And maybe the suggestion that I shouldn't have is actually contravening the court order. It may be in contempt as well. So, technically speaking, getting legal advice from the Solicitor General's office and the advice was subsequently upheld by the court shows that the Solicitor General's office and the court also upheld that I was correct in obtaining that legal advice, and that is where I leave the matter to rest.
Now, if the Electoral Commission does something that you need clarification on, who do you get your advice from?
The first stop is with myself. It is my team. We discuss the matter. If it's a legal issue and it deals with interpretation of a section or legality of any or lawfulness of any of the instructions, we first deal with it ourselves. And if we are still in need of further advice, we go to the Solicitor General's office to get the legal opinion. And that legal opinion is what we then... it's an opinion, and we can choose to follow it or we can choose not to follow it.
And you do have a lot of time constraints. Of course, you have 20 days to go, and last Friday you were in that situation. Definitely some things may have been delayed based on how things played out.
Well, everybody is entitled to their day in court, and we had this in court. Had it not gone to court, we would have had the draw. Still the draw would have been done. Only thing would have been that the list would have been published earlier, and we would have gone for printing of ballot papers and the voter instruction booklet earlier. However, no love lost. We still managed to get that done in time. And with the decision, many things were clarified, and we are in the same business, the Electoral Commission and the Fijian Elections Office.
Talking about that, no love lost. Some people are talking about, okay, these two, the supervisor and the Electoral Commission, they seem to have differences and misunderstanding. That is why this happened. Are you saying no love lost, so everything is hunky-dory and we moving ahead with ensuring that we deliver free and fair elections?
Of course. I think the one thing that the court case certified was that there is 100% commitment to running the election in a free and fair mode. And the checks and balance process, the manner in which the court matter was handled, the cooperation between the parties in court and out of court, as the chairman said, on the day the decision was made, the Electoral Commission was in fact working with us to finalize the notice of poll. So whilst we were very professionally waiting for a decision in court, we were also continuing the work towards elections. There was no stoppages. There was nothing. We just continued. There were things to be done because the decree does not give room for anybody to wait. There are prescribed timelines. You need to work within that. If you breach that, you have breached the decree. And for that reason, the court case in itself was a clarification, and we respected that, but we did not let that get in the middle of the preparations to elections. It was still something that contributed towards preparation.
So basically, if even if the Electoral Commission for some reason does not follow the decree, you have to act.
We follow the decree.
Now Nilesh from Suva has a question. Good evening, Nilesh. Narayan from Navua is first up. Good evening, Narayan.
My question is this: what about while we in the queue and there is a heavy rain and people get wet while voting, they spoil the ballot papers. And if there are 37 ballot papers and 40 people are on the line, in that scenario, what we gonna do in that polling season? That question one. Second question of mine is this: what about if people are in the queue and if they get sick, fainted, or might be old people? What is the arrangement? Is there for the people to, who going to look after those kind of people, please?
Mr. Saneem. Thank you. Well, if you are in a school facility, I'd hope that you don't get wet in the rain. Normally they have corridors at the classrooms. But if that is not available, and you say, for example, the scenario is you said, there's shortage of ballot papers, the presiding officer can make arrangements with the area office, and we will then try and produce additional ballot papers, all of which will have to be properly accounted for at the end of the day. The other matter that the person asked about was elderly. In our trainings, this is my request to the general voter public, that on election day, if an elderly person or a person who has got disabilities wishes to come and vote, and the presiding officer gives them first opportunity as we have trained them, please be very patient. It is courtesy to the people who have such disabilities or who are old or who are maybe pregnant. And we hope that people come are able to exercise common sense, allow them to go and vote, and they will. That's how we are training our people, so that we give due courtesy to people with needs.
Nilesh from Suva has a question for the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem. Good evening, Nilesh.
Thank you, Mr. Mohammed Saneem, for your views all this while. Just so one question: I've seen that poll starts at 7:30. Why cannot be a little bit earlier, around about 6? Or 5:30, people go for morning walk. During their morning walk, there's the time they can go and vote and come home and read the news and anything. Can you elaborate on that, please?
Thank you, Nilesh. It's a very good point.
You can't do that.
I think what we have to do is be considerate of the polling day workers as well. Allow in getting them at 1400 places to set up at 6:30 in the morning might be quite demanding, considering some of the terrains that we have to travel across to reach the places, which would mean some drivers don't sleep all night because they have to drive across these treacherous roads some places. Whilst your comment is valued, I think it would be inconsiderate for some people, whilst you might be benefiting for some people. And also the electoral decree says you have to start at 7:30 to 6 p.m. 6 p.m. So, yeah.
Deem from Malolo Island, good evening.
Our transport from the island to the mainland, who will be responsible for the payment?
You will be entitled to your vote if you come to your polling station.
We'll take a short break and be right back with the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem.
Straight Talk with Vijay Narayan, brought to you by Bonwell.
Good evening. Our in-studio guest tonight is the Supervisor of Elections, Mohammed Saneem, on Straight Talk, as we get him to come in and to ensure that whatever questions you have, that he will clarify all the issues so that you are all set come pre-polling or polling day on September 17th, that you know exactly what you're dealing with, how the process is working, to ensure that you are ready to go and cast your vote. Now, Mr. Saneem, in relation to your other role as Registrar of Political Parties, for the first time ever, political parties, their candidates and officials have to declare what they earn, what they own, and what they owe. However, questions have been raised on whether proper verification is being carried out to ensure that true and accurate declarations are being made. Calls are being made by parties to you as the Registrar of Political Parties to verify the declaration of assets and liabilities submitted by certain parties and officials so far. Fiji First General Secretary Ayad Said Kayum says They can see that some party leaders have not submitted their full details. He raised this concern a few weeks ago, around mid-July. The declarations by the Fiji Labour Party in Sodelpa were made in June last year. According to Sodelpa leader Rotemumu Kepa's declaration at that time, she had no source of funds and there was $1,000 cash in bank. The declaration submitted in June last year also shows that Fiji Labour Party leader Mahendra Chaudhary has total assets amounting to about $3.8 million, while his wife Hannah Virmati, $78,000 worth of assets. The breakdown of the assets and the source of funds was not published. Now, Sodelpa leader Rotemumu Kepa, when we asked her, she said she has made all the declarations. Of course, you would have the latest declarations. Chaudhary, we asked him, he said he made his declaration and no one has come back to ask for any verification. Chaudhary has come back and said the real issue is for the Fiji First to disclose the source of the $636,000 worth of assets that it has declared. Where is the source of those assets? He said they also want the declaration of the Fiji First leader and general secretary to be investigated. Now, the political party's decree states that a party should submit to the registrar a written declaration giving details of all assets and expenditure, including all contributions, donations or pledges or contributions or donations, whether in cash or in kind, made or to be made to the initial assets of the political party. The declaration submitted to the registrar shall state the sources of all funds and other assets of the political party. This is a new system in place for the first time in Fiji. Can you please explain what is happening?
Yes, Vijay, I think it has been one of those pending issues that you have been asking about for all this while. Let me explain that when we receive declarations, we ask for the same to be clarified from banks, financial institutions. And once we have received that, we ask for the candidate itself for clarifications. And there have been certain instances where things didn't match. But then there have been subsequent declarations following the decree, and we have kept that as well. So I can tell you again, I'm not required to disclose that, and if there is any enforcement proceedings that happen, the relevant enforcement authority will take it. The declarations have been done. Some of the declarations were not in compliant completely, and that is why we have devised a form from the elections office. The form contains the specific details that the person has to submit as per the decree, and the declarations that have come after the nomination of candidates are in conformity with the form, and the declarations that will be published shortly, and you can then have your look at the details that have been submitted and make your own calls. Now, the other aspect of this is where the parties are calling this and that and that and that. The Registrar of Political Parties does not act on media reports. As a Registrar of Political Party, I must ensure that in the quasi-judicial role that I play, I always independent and impartial, and I have evidence and substantial claims submitted to me, personally and directly, so that it is possible for me to verify.
So these parties should contact you with all the details, the issues raised?
Making calls over the media does not become a registered complaint to the registrar, and that is where I invite parties if they have sufficient evidence to forward that to me.
Now, are verifications complete for the parties and the political party officials?
Yes, we had done the first round of verifications. We got back to certain certain officials of the party, and we have spoken with them.
Now, as far as those verifications are concerned, you're saying that the decree does not allow you to go further in saying then, okay, these areas, these people did not verify correctly and things like that. Will that ever be known?
It does.
Right.
And we deal with that with the person concerned.
Right.
So.
But you don't have to publish.
I am not required to publish that, and
right.
I cannot.
That's what I'm asking. You can't disclose that publicly.
No.
So if there was any wrong declaration or false declaration made,
it is referred to for prosecution.
So that is the only time it will come forward if it is done and it goes to court.
Yes.
Now, how are you verifying the details? You gave some details about banks and financial institutions so that people can understand it's a new system.
Yes. Under the decree, the registrar is empowered to ask for information, and any person who is asked for information is required to supply the information required. and we have had great cooperation from all the financial sectors in this regard, and they have provided details.
For the candidates, the 248 candidates, their deadline has expired. They've all given in their declaration.
Yes, they have. Yes.
Now, you have to publish that in the next few days.
Yes.
When is that happening?
In the next few days.
Now, after you do that, the verification of the declaration, of course, because we've just got 20 days left.
Yes.
Will you be able to do that before September 17th?
Yes. One of the things that has happened is in our experience from the first round of declarations to now, we have managed to establish certain guidelines as to how we can approach this in a very efficient manner. And the declarations from candidates will be carefully scrutinized in terms of accuracy and in terms of the submissions that we have received. And we will be using that to be able to very efficiently conduct that. And the penalty, if there is false declaration in this case, would be, I think, there is a fine,
$50,000.
So we will be ensuring that the candidate's one is also verified just like others.
Now, Joe from Pacific Harbour has a question. Good evening, Joe.
If after the election, and if a particular party is not happy with the result of the election, would there be allowed to verify the process and check it with the party?
Depends on what process the gentleman is talking about, but as for the count, on the night, if a party is not satisfied with the count, they can ask for a recount. Thereafter, they would have to petition court.
Right.
Yes.
So one recount, and if the parties are still not satisfied, you take the matter to court.
Yes.
Kamlesh from Lambasa, what's your question, Kamlesh?
Good evening, Mr. Saneem. This question is for Mr. Saneem, of course. Could you tell us what is the role of the Electoral Commission? We have noted that a decision was made by the Electoral Commission. It was overruled by the Supervisor of Election, and now we are having a gentleman from Bar who is charged for a very serious offence. He is going into the election, contesting the election. A gentleman from Lambasa who has been charged for a minor offence has been dropped off. I would like to know if the Electoral Commission does not have a role, does not have an authority over making such decisions, why it is there?
Thank you. I think Kamlesh from Lambasa has slightly misconstrued the matter. The Electoral Commission is in charge with certain priorities under the electoral decree. They are charged with the elections as well under the constitution. The supervisor has not overruled the electoral commission in any case. What has simply happened is that there is a deadline for decisions by the electoral commission, which was 4 p.m. on Friday. If there are no decisions reached or received or made by that time, then the electoral commission ran out of time and their decisions were no longer binding. That is what happened. Whether the person is charged with a criminal offence or a money laundering offence or whatever be the case, until and unless a person is convicted, they cannot be held to be guilty of the offence. And I think Kamlesh needs to understand this as well, that if a person has been charged for an offence, it's only a charge, and the person is to be presumed innocent until proven guilty. So in this case, whilst the decision didn't come on time, if it had, circumstances would have been different.
But at this point in time, of course, there was a deadline. The commission did not bring forward those decisions to you on time.
Yes.
And you could not make that change as they had wanted.
Yes, and I rely on the High Court ruling in that regard as well. And it is clearly stipulated in the ruling that they had to give the decision by 4 p.m.
The question about some people who may have... So were supposed to be in people's minds, and
yes,
some people were supposed to be out. The fact that issue prevails as we go on.
Yes.
What is your comment on that?
Well, one matter I wish to clarify is that the candidate who was rejected, that is in the matter of contention at the moment, the record, the police record still stipulates the presence of the offence.
Right.
And on the basis, on the face of the prima facie evidence, which is the police record of the conviction, any authority is required to follow it. You don't have to go behind it. Until and unless the person who knew of the record should have submitted, together with the nomination, sufficient proof to say that the record does not exist. At the time the person filed his nomination, he should have done his own due diligence into this effect. That why am I not supposed to be, why do I still have this conviction? Now, if a person does not do that on his own accord, and on the face of the evidence, the person's nomination was rejected, I think the person has to do some his own research into the area as to what is his own falling behind. The subsequent questions as to why no verification was done, that is after the fact. It's your first responsibility is when you submit your nomination, you have declared that you don't have this, and if there is an existence of a conviction on your record, it is your responsibility to have that removed if you believe that it's supposed to be removed. So on the face of the conviction, on the face of the police report that I have, and any person wishes to inspect can write to it, you will see that the conviction exists, it is still there, and it is not removed. So the person cannot claim that the supervisor was unfair in treating him. I think that has to be very clearly understood by the person.
Very good that you clearly have stated that it's the person's responsibility. What about the other case where there's some party saying that they had given enough evidence that the particular person was a public officer still?
In that case, it was an evidence supplied to the Electoral Commission under an objection. Evidence was not supplied at the time of nomination.
So you didn't get any of that?
I don't get any of that. I only get a decision from the Electoral Commission advising when the person's objections have been upheld. If it's not upheld, I don't get the decision as well under the decree.
If somebody is a public officer or a trade unionist and applies to or is nominated for the elections, we've had even a number of people saying that they will take it up to that point, and as soon as they get nominated, that straight away they have deemed to have resigned from the other position?
Yes.
So just please explain that before we finish off.
Well, the operation of the law is such, and if the person has proof on the allegations that they're saying, that proof has to be made known to the relevant authority, the right authority. And in this case, the authority was the Electoral Commission. Now, if someone comes to allege that the supervisor of elections having had full knowledge, unfortunately, no. The supervisor didn't have full knowledge. Supervisor was not provided with any evidence, and the allegations that are there are mere allegations until you provide evidence to the supervisor of that, and that is where the case all happened, and if the decision was not on time, it is not the fault of the person who continued with the process. I think the person has to ensure that when they supply information, it is supplied to the right authority, and then it's up to the authority. And in this case, it was not the Supervisor of Elections.
Thank you very much, Supervisor of Elections. Just before we finish off, definitely the 20 days left for the elections. You have next Wednesday already, you're saying about 50,000 people will turn out for pre-polling venues. You'll have critics coming along the way. You know that that is already happening. How are you handling it as a person?
I appreciate it when we get critics. It gives us the opportunity to look into something or re-look into something. And when we re-look into something, we might find something that the person didn't find, but you yourself found. And that keeps us on a checks and balance process. We have observers on the ground now. We have party agents. We have very informed media. And all this is proving towards a very, very healthy in checks and balance process. And we just hope that everybody is able to find out where they're voting, and they are able to come to the polling venue on the day.
That was the Supervisor of Elections, Mr. Mohammed Saneem. 20 days to go for the general elections. And as I said earlier, pre-polling starts from the 3rd of September. You can stay listening to our stations. We'll be bringing you the pre-polling venues, the dates and the times on where you have to go and vote if you are located in the pre-polling area. And at the same time, September 17th is the day of polling for everyone else who is not covered under pre-polling. Postal vote applications have closed, and we'll get some numbers out by tomorrow morning from the elections office. And also to let you know that Straight Talk, we are currently planning to have a Straight Talk tomorrow night to start off our double party talkbacks, and we have the president of the National Federation Party, Tupoun Rowning Dalo, confirmed, and we are trying to get another president of a party. We should have that confirmation this evening, if not tomorrow morning. Stay listening. We will bring you that confirmation and who is on tomorrow night on Straight Talk as we join you again at 7 o'clock. You that confirmation and who is on tomorrow night on